morning and welcome. This is our special online church service that we hold each week. Thank you for joining us. If you're joining us for the first time, we hope that you're going to enjoy this service with us. If you have not done so already, we recommend that you subscribe to the channel and also like the service today so that it can be promoted on YouTube. Our first service follows a standard program where we start with the opening prayer, which is then followed by our worship songs. And then we have the speaking of life video, and then we give a short message on giving, which followed by a scripture reading and the message of the day. And then after that, we have the last worship song, and then the blessing at the end. So once again, thank you for joining us. Let's go into the service. We'll start with the opening prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday and welcome to today's service. Today is a brand new day that the Lord has made, one that is filled with love, joy and serenity, one that we've been blessed with to hear what God still has to say and do in our lives. With that being said, let's bow our heads and pray for today's service. Dear Lord, we humbly come before you today and give you grace and honor as we have gathered here today as proof of your goodness and also as our way of being grateful for your faithfulness. Lord, I pray for everyone who has made an effort in attending today's service. Lord, we ask you to breathe into today's service because it is only your breath that can make today's service a success. Let us leave this service better than we came here spiritually. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? Heart could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me. Declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh,
In the quiet embrace of dawn, the world stirs with a promise of new life. As the sun's first rays cast aside the shadows of the night, we are reminded of a profound truth that the resurrection of Jesus brings forth the dawn of our own resurrection. Easter Sunday heralds a symphony of hope, for the tomb could not contain the author of life. In his rising, we too find our own awakening, intricately woven with the very essence of the one who conquered death. Through the incarnation, we have been intricately connected with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bonded by love, we stand as one, sharing in the victory of the empty tomb. As we gather in worship, hearts united with Christ and one another, we rejoice in the truth that our resurrection is bound to His. In the dance of life, we find our steps guided by the risen Christ, leading us towards the fullness of His promise. Just as spring bursts forth in glorious bloom, so too does the resurrection of Christ herald the ultimate restoration of all creation. His plan, so intricately woven into the very fabric of time, surpasses our finite understanding. In the brilliance of Easter's dawn, we are reminded that Jesus is not finished with us. He beckons us forward towards the fullness of His restored creation, where every tear will be wiped away and every heart will find its true home. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, He will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove His people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, "Surely this is our God. We trusted in Him and He saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in Him. Let us rejoice and be glad in His salvation." Resurrection, redemption, restoration. May we walk in the fullness of His glorious truth. He is risen.
Greetings all. My name is Sekgomotso Makata from Mohlakeng GCI. One question, brethren. What motivates you to give? What is that one thing that pushes you to offer what you have? Our Father in heaven gave us His only begotten Son because of one motive, because of one reason. He gave us His Son because He loved the world. Nothing else. He gave us His only begotten Son because He loved the world. Brethren, are we giving to get? That is our motive. Let us embrace what our Father has done. Let us take what our Father has done and be practical with it. Let us give, being motivated by love. Let us give, let us offer, being motivated by what motivated our Father, which is love. He gave His only begotten Son. He didn't have any sons. He only had one Son, Christ. He only gave what He had. Brethren, let us hear in our Bibles why and the results on giving only what we have. Let us read Psalms chapter 126 verse 5, short scripture. It reads like this, brethren. Those who plant in tears will harvest with shouts of joy. I believe, brethren, when you give that only thing that you have, it is not a simple thing. To give the one thing that you have, it is not a simple task, brethren. And our Father gave His only begotten Son. And here is the scripture saying to us, those who plant in tears, those who give in tears, troubled, will harvest with shouts of joy. Our Father gave His only begotten sons, begotten Son. And today we shout with joy. The result is we shout with joy. I believe it is not simple to give what you only have, but we will shout with joy. Whenever we harvest, we will shout with joy, brethren. Let us embrace giving and let us remember we give out of love, nothing else, brethren. In Jesus' name, Amen.
So the passage today that I want us to examine is the passage from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15. It's a familiar chapter, but the lectionary gives us only the first 11 verses for today. So I would like to read the passage before we go into it in some level of detail. It says, "Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed. That's our passage for today. I've divided it into three sections. The first section is verse 1 and 2 that we read. It says, "Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you." Now, Paul was the founder of the church in Corinth. In the book of Acts, chapter 18, we are told that he spent 18 months in Corinth establishing that church. So it was a church that was close to his heart. That is why, for example, we have two epistles. In fact, some scholars believe that there were three letters to the church in Corinth. But the third one has been lost. We don't have it. But it is referenced in 1 Corinthians. So it looks like it was written before 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians probably will be the second, and 2 Corinthians will be the third if we didn't lose that other epistles. So Paul valued and was concerned about the church in Corinth. Now, one of the things that probably was the case was that the idea of the resurrection was beginning to bother some people. So we find that in the whole book of 1 Corinthians, Paul addresses a lot of the issues that were affecting the church. But he starts in 1 Corinthians 2 talking about the death of Jesus. And then at the end in chapter 15, he talks about the resurrection. And in between, he talks about the problems of Corinth. So you can almost say, Paul says the problems that the church in Corinth faced are enveloped by the death and the resurrection of Jesus. The death of Jesus he covers in chapter 2, and the resurrection he covers in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. So you can see that all the problems that the church in Corinth faced, Paul presents them to us in the light of the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And that is how we must understand the gospel. That is what he says to them. He says, "For what I have," I remind you of the gospel I preached to you. And that is the gospel that he preached to them. The gospel of Jesus, who died, was buried, and rose again. So I would like us then to go to the second part, which is from verse 3 to verse 8. And this is where he talks about the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus. Verse 3 says, "For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance." Paul says, "What I received from Jesus, I passed on to you as of first importance." So for Paul, what he's about to say is of first importance. That is something that he doesn't want the Corinthians to miss. And that is something you and I today should never miss. Because that is what is of first importance that Jesus taught Paul. "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." What is that? "That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." That's verse 3. What Paul believes is of first importance is that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Now, he says according to the scriptures because the death of Jesus was not an accident by the Roman Empire. It was not the Roman soldiers. It was not Pilate. It was not the Sanhedrin. It was not the Jewish leaders who killed Jesus. Jesus died because the scriptures said he will die for our sins. So Paul wants to highlight that fact. He wants to flag that to us, to say the death of Jesus that we commemorated on Friday was not an accident. The scriptures predicted that death hundreds, if not thousands of years before it happened. Which is why the gospel is not a myth. Because it was predicted before it happened, and it happened as it was predicted. And that is the message that Paul gave to the Corinthians, that Jesus died for our sins, as the scriptures predicted. Now, the fact that Jesus died, you'll find that if you are familiar with the Apostles' Creed, the Apostles' Creed is the statement of beliefs of Christians that was developed around the 300s-400s, because it was taken out of what the apostles wrote about, and part of it actually comes from this passage we just read today. It says, I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary, who lived and died, suffered under Pontius Pilate, died and was buried, and rose on the third day. Now, all those facts that we see repeated in the Apostles' Creed, this is what Paul tells us. And so when the early Christians developed what we call the Apostles' Creed today, which is a statement of faith, they were using the basis of what the apostles believed. Often we look back and say, how was a man like Paul able to change his life around and was willing to travel the length and breadth of the Roman Empire, was willing to face death every day? What moved this man? What moved Paul was the fact that Jesus Christ died for our sins. And this is what he believes to be of most importance. And he wants the people in Corinth not to miss that point. In 1 Colossians chapter 3, verse 3, Paul says, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. According to Paul, we have died. The death of Jesus takes us into itself. So when Jesus died, we died with him. And this is why for Paul, this is of first importance, that when we look at the death of Jesus, which we commemorate on Friday, we must not look at it in isolation of us. We must look at it as including us. Last year, we discussed about the three crosses, where we showed how the death of Jesus included all of humanity. Those who believe and those who don't believe. That's what the two crosses also represent. And therefore, the death of Jesus on Good Friday, or that we commemorate on Good Friday, includes us. And therefore, it is of paramount importance that when we say we believe in the gospel, we believe in the fact that Jesus died. And to believe in the fact that Jesus died is to believe that I died to my life of sin. And the question we should ask ourselves, the question I should ask myself, have I died or has Jesus died alone? Because that's the question that we must ask ourselves. This weekend, as we commemorate the death, the burial and resurrection of Jesus, we must ask ourselves, has Jesus died alone or have I died with him, as the scriptures say? Because Paul says, the first point that he believes is of most importance is that Christ died. And as he says in Colossians 3 verse 3, he says, you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. I'm going to leave you with that question. Have you died? Or is your old self still fully alive? The second part is in verse 4. And this is still part of what Paul says is of first importance. He says in verse 4 that he was buried. Now, it needed to be stated that Jesus was buried. Because some might say, maybe he appeared to have died. And therefore, the resurrection was not really a resurrection. It was somebody coming out of a coma. It was somebody who woke up from sleep. But the scriptures go to a lot of detail in telling us that Jesus died and was buried, as verse 4 says. The Apostles' Creed says he was buried. Now we know in the book of John we are told, for example, let's just read the passage in John chapter 19, verse 38. He says, later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, He came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus. So John tells us in John 19, verse 38, that after the soldiers had confirmed, remember the cause of crucifixion was to kill you. So the soldiers were meant to ensure that the person that they crucify actually dies. So they verified that he died. And Joseph of Arimathea goes to Pilate and he asks for the body so that he can bury it. And he doesn't go alone. He goes with Nicodemus. And Nicodemus was a Pharisee. So he had a lot of Pharisees who were his friends. So we have witnesses of the death and the burial of Jesus by the top Pharisees. So the rumors and the allegations that the Jewish leaders wanted to make to say the disciples have stolen the body of Jesus could not be substantiated. But at least the fact of the matter is that they knew that he died and he was buried because one of them actually buried Jesus. And you and I must ask ourselves the same question once again. Have we died and have we been buried? If you're familiar with baptism, you'll know that in Romans 6, verse 1, Paul says, we no longer live in sin because we have been buried with Christ in baptism. So not only was the death of Jesus including us, his burial included us. In the waters of baptism, when we are baptized in the waters of baptism, we represent that his burial also included us. So when Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus buried Jesus, they were buried the whole of humanity in that tomb of Jesus. So that the burial of Jesus was a known fact. There was nobody who could dispute that. In fact, the Jewish leaders appointed guards at the tomb, as you know. They put guards there to make sure that he dies, he's buried, and he rots in the grave. Because they knew he had said, if you kill me, I'll rise in the third day. And they didn't want a claim by the apostles claiming that he rose when he didn't rise. We have seen scandals of fake people being raised from the dead. In our own country, we've had a pastor who hired somebody to come pretending to be dead in a coffin and pretending to raise them from the dead. Of course, that was exposed as fake. But Jesus Christ, they tried to make his death and resurrection appear like it was fake, but they could not do it. So he was buried. And the third point that Paul believes is of most importance is in the second part of verse 4. So he says he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. So in verse 4, he reminds us again that not only was he buried, he rose on the third day according to the scriptures. Not only was the death of Jesus according to the scriptures, his resurrection was according to the scriptures. The scriptures predicted hundreds and thousands of years before that Jesus will die and he will rise on the third day. He himself told his disciples, he told the Jewish leaders that he will die. If they kill him, he will rise on the third day. So the death of Jesus is central to our faith. In fact, later in the book, which is not part of this passage, Paul says, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, you and I must burn our Bibles, we must stop going to church, we must carry on with our lives, because there is no hope for humanity. But according to Paul, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus is the pillar of the gospel of Jesus. It is because Jesus died and was buried and rose on the third day that humanity has hope. And the hope we have today, the hope that you and I carry today, is founded on this truth that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again. Now, Paul goes into a lot of detail about telling us about the witnesses to this resurrection. He says in verse 5, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brethren at the same time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also as one abnormally born. So Paul doesn't just say Jesus rose from the dead. He says he appeared to Peter. He appeared to 500 believers at the same time. And Paul says many of them are still alive. So if you were in Corinth and you wanted to verify whether Paul was telling the truth, you could travel to Jerusalem. You could travel to Judea and Galilee. And you'll find some of these 500 people who saw Jesus after the resurrection, who will witness to you and say, we saw him alive. He is risen. But you will notice that in Paul's telling of this story, he doesn't mention the women. Now we know in the gospel records, the women were the first to discover that Jesus is not in the tomb. Mary Magdalene was the first that Jesus appeared to at the tomb. And he told her not to touch him because he needs to ascend to the Father. Now you will know that in those days, women did not have much standing in society. So the testimony of women was not valued. So Paul knows that if he starts quoting Mary Magdalene and the women that we heard from the women that Jesus rose, they will see that as a women's fairy tale, which is, I believe, one of the reasons that Paul here doesn't tell us about the fact that Jesus first appeared to women. So he gives them credible sources, sources that they can believe in. And then he puts himself and say, me too, Jesus appeared to me after his resurrection. I am witness to that. Now, if you didn't know that, when Jesus says the disciples will be his witnesses, it was about witnessing to his resurrection, his death, burial, and resurrection. Because that is what the core of the gospel is. In the parallel passage for this Sunday, for today, in Acts chapter 10, verse 41, Peter was visiting Cornelius, a Roman centurion, a Roman soldier. And he says to him in verse 41, he was not seen by all the people, talking about Jesus. After the resurrection, Jesus was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen. So Jesus didn't rise from the dead and walk the streets of Judea and Galilee and Jerusalem so that the public can see him. Because he had chosen the people who were going to be his witnesses, people who were going to witness to his resurrection. And you and I today, by the testimony of those who saw him, by the testimony of the apostles, like Paul, who gives us 1 Corinthians chapter 15, by believing in this testimony, you and I today, we can be witnesses too. As we said, we too have died, have been buried, and have been raised with Jesus. We too can say we have seen the risen Jesus because he lives in us. And the third question I want to ask, have we been raised with him? Have we been raised with Jesus? Brethren, the foundation of our faith, what you and I believe, must be sealed by the gospel. It must be sealed by the fact that Jesus died, was buried, and rose on the third day. Now, how that comes to us today? Today, you and I, we confirm that through baptism. That's what baptism represents. That's why Jesus says, those who believe that I lived and died and was buried and rose on the third day, you must baptize them, because baptism combines us, unites us with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection. So baptism is a very critical piece of Christianity. Just as we believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, baptism is the seal of that faith, of that belief. And the question I have today, for those of you who are not baptized, is if you take this gospel seriously, if you have come to understand that indeed Jesus is not a myth, there are men like Paul who were willing to risk everything. Paul risked his whole reputation as a Pharisee. He started off as a persecutor of the church, wanting to kill everybody who was preaching Jesus. But when he met the resurrected Jesus, his life turned around. And he was willing to go to the ends of the world. He was willing to face the Roman Empire. He was willing to face Caesar in Rome. And we know how many times he was beaten, flogged. For what purpose? Because the fact that Jesus died and rose again was an undisputable fact. It was not a hearsay story for Paul. He saw that. He saw that. We know in 1 John, John tells us that we tell you about that which we have seen, that which we have touched. We tell you about the one with whom we have sat and ate with. That's what Peter told Cornelius, that we sat with him and we ate him with him after the resurrection. So the question I have for you is whether the Jesus you believe in is a living Jesus or a dead Jesus. If he is a living Jesus, does your life reflect that? Because the life of the apostles, the first witnesses of the resurrected Jesus, were completely transformed. They live a different kind of life. Nothing could sway them or stop them from preaching the gospel. When Peter and John appeared before the Sanhedrin, they said, "You can't stop us. We are not going to listen to you. We are going to preach Jesus, even if you kill us." And that is the faith that they had, because they believed in this resurrected Jesus. And today, as we celebrate Resurrection Sunday, we are reminded of the fact that not only did Jesus rise up from the dead 2,000 years ago, we are reminded by Paul that we share in that resurrection, that the resurrected Jesus lives in us, that we no longer live, but Christ lives in us. And because of that, our lives are transformed. When people look at us, they can see the Takalani they knew 20, 30 years ago. If I meet friends who knew me 20, 30 years ago, they should not see the same person they knew you back then. They must see a transformed person. They must see a new person. That is what the resurrection of Jesus makes of us. That we are transformed once it hits home. Once Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, lives in us, we are transformed. In Colossians chapter 3, which we went to earlier, I just want to read the first three verses, because they tell us something that Paul preached in all the churches that he wrote to and wherever he was. Okay? Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. Colossians 3, verse 1. He says, "Since then, you have been raised with Christ." Have you been raised with Christ? Because Paul says, you have been raised. He says it as a matter of fact. He says, "Since you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above." Since you have been raised with Christ, set your eyes on things above. Where are you setting your eyes today? Are your eyes set on things in the world or on things above in heaven? Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, he says in verse 2. And verse 3, which we read earlier, he says, "For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God." When Christ, who is your life, because today Because we have died and our life are hidden with Christ in God, the life we have today is the life of Christ. So he says, your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, you will also appear with him in glory. And then he says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Because you have been raised with Christ, put to death your earthly nature. Remember, we started by saying, Paul says, what was so most important that Christ died. And Paul says in verse 3 of Colossians 3, sorry, verse 4, 5 of Colossians 3, that if it is indeed that you died, if it is that your life is hidden with Christ in God, if it is that Christ is living in you, then put to death the earthly nature. And then he describes that earthly nature. He says sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, idolatry. He says these things are the earthly nature, which because we have died and have been raised with Jesus and Jesus lives in us, these are the things we must put to death. These are things that we must get rid of in our lives. They must not be spoken of amongst us. One of the most terrible, it starts with sexual immorality. And today we still find not only ordinary Christians, pastors involved in sexual immorality. These are things we must put to death. Our society, it is a sexually immoral society. But that should not be us who have been raised with Jesus, who live a new life. That should not be us. And the last part of 1 Corinthians 15, verses 9 to 11. I just want to read this as we close the message for today. Verse 9 to 11. He says, for I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. By the grace of God, Paul is what he was. It was the grace of God that Paul became a Christian. Otherwise, according to him, if it was up to him, he would have been the persecutor of the church for all his life. But by the grace of Jesus, by the grace of God, Jesus went to him and said, I want you, stop persecuting me and my people. That's why Paul will say, by the grace of God, I am an apostle today. By the grace of God, I am a child of God today. I am a Christian today. By the grace of God, you are a child of God. By the grace of God, we are children of God. It is not something that we've done. In fact, he continues to say in the second part of verse 10, let's read the verse 10 in full. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and this grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Paul says, having seen the resurrected Jesus, I worked harder than all the apostles that were called before me. And then he catches himself in the act. Then he says, not I, but the grace of God that was me was working harder than the other apostles. So Paul was not under any illusion that the work he was doing for Jesus was his own strength and his own desires. He knew it was by the grace of God that he was doing what he was doing. And you and I today, it is by the grace of God that we can stand and say we're Christians. It is by the grace of God that we can stand. And it is that grace that sustains us every day. And today, as we celebrate the resurrection, we are reminded of that grace. That grace that has come into our lives. That our lives can be changed. That our lives can be different. That we can say, I no longer believe, but Christ lives in me. That I have died, and the earthly nature of me, the sexual immorality, the greed, the impurity, the lust, those are dead. but not because of my strength, but by the grace of God. That is what Jesus has done. Then he says in verse 11, whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed. And when we have become believers, we carry the message forward. We become witnesses as well. And you and I today are the witnesses of the resurrected Jesus. When people look at us, they must understand that the Jesus we talk about is indeed alive. Because there is no people who will dedicate their lives in the way you and I will do if this story is not true. The truth of the gospel is in the witnesses who saw it. And their lives are witnesses to that. And you and I today, our lives are witnesses to that. So part of the message we receive on this day is that you and I must become witnesses of that. Jesus did not rise and reveal himself to everyone. He revealed himself to his witnesses. You and I are amongst those witnesses. And the expectations of Jesus is that he sends us, just as the Father sent him and he sent the apostles. Today he sends us that we too can be witnesses to his resurrection. And that's what the love venue of a healthy church means. To witness to the resurrected Jesus. May we all be witnesses. May we all testify in our daily lives that Jesus Christ is risen. Amen. Like a river.
Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen.
There's no question of your love for me. There's no fear in your love. You have proven time and time again, and there's no reason to doubt. I was sinking deep inside when you came calling for me. Oh, what a savior, oh, what a salvation we have received by grace. Hope I have in you, I will not be ashamed. What a story of your amazing grace. I was lost, now I'm found, and overflowing with gratitude for all of the things you do. My heart's desire is just to be truly able to sing this song. Hey! I really do.
I love you. by grace. Everlasting, everlasting, precious love of God. Oh, what a Savior, oh, what a salvation we have received by grace. Sing it now.
Salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.